And he claps my hand and he said, "It's so good to see you." And I can remember that as though it was yesterday.
Ed Green may have only been 10 years old when he met Joe the Barber Barbera, but the experience will last a lifetime. Ed's father, Robert, operated the Robert J. Green Contracting Company and was doing work for Charles F. Johnson at the time. After a referral from the Johnsons, Robert Green was asked to do work at the Barbera's Canada Dry Bottling Factory and eventually his iconic Appalachian estate. Long after police raided the home in 1957, Barbera became ill and was ready to give up the estate. It deserved a rightful owner, so Barbera gave Robert Green first dibs at buying the Appalachian home for $75,000.
We went to church at St. Patrick's and rode down in our Ford station wagon, pulled into the rotary station there, and within a matter of minutes, up pulls two black cars, and one was a black limousine, and I wanted shotgun in the limousine, of course.
They arrived as a family and entered the Barbera home, made up of a massive living room with three sets of furniture, a kitchen, a basement with a stockpile of food, two poker tables, a caretaker's building, a barn, and a vineyard.
We were all enamored by it. I mean, they had horses in the paddock, and there was a thing that they never, you have intercoms and cell phones now, but there was a communication system with these crank phones, like walkie-talkies between all of the buildings. And it was, I think there was a total of either 5 to 7 outbuildings there.
Although the house did have a lot to offer, Green had a difficult time deciding what to do. He asked Ed what he thought of the move and having to start all over again in Appalachian.
You'd have to take buses. You'd have to get up at 6 o'clock in the morning, maybe even 5:30. A week away, Appalachian schools. He said, "You're out in farm country." And it was. It was nothing developed like it is today.
Green feared the home and the history behind it would give him a bad reputation in the business community. Ultimately, Green decided not to buy it.
My father came and sat down with all of us, and he said, "No, you know, I've provided well for all of you, given you everything you want, and I continue to do that. But," he says, "who knows what the impact of this will have on my business?" And I think he made the right decision then.
While Ed Green didn't get to live in the house, he did get something from the barber that day. Joe's wife, Josephine, invited Robert and his family to visit the barber, who was under a nurse's care in the master bedroom. Ed pulled on his father's sleeve and asked if he could join him. They entered the room, approached Barbera, and Ed was taken back by the boss, who had something to give to the young man.
Reached in the drawer and pulled out something, put it in his hand, and he called me over to his bedside and put a $20 gold piece in my hand. And I looked at it, and I said, "Well, what?" And he goes, puts his fingers to his lips. He says, "That's for you, young man." And he says, "And that's because I like you." And he says, you're probably your father's favorite, aren't you?" And I says, "I probably am."
After our interview, Green wanted to pay his respects to Barbera, who died in 1959, a year and a half after the bust. Barbera is buried here at Calvary Cemetery in Johnson City. While his actual gravestone remains untouched, the family monument was vandalized in the late 1980s. As you can see, Jesus' arms were actually ripped off, and dozens of other gravestones were defaced or destroyed. Green says he doesn't regret his father saying no to the Barbera home and feels that he made the right decision. Although they didn't get a house, Ed can say the Barberas made his family an offer that they could refuse.